ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। असतो मा सद्गमय, तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय, असतो मा सद्गमय, तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय, मृत्योर्मामृतंगमय। ॐ शांति शांति शांति।
Let us offer our salutations to Sri Ramakrishna, who came to re-establish Dharma in the world, who came to show us the way to perfection, the way to supreme peace and bliss. By following his life and teachings, we would be purifying our heart. At the same time, we would be able to dispel the darkness of ignorance, we would be able to move onwards in our spiritual path, and finally we would be able to reach the goal. Just to follow Sri Ramakrishna's life and teachings, that's all that is required. You know how the situation now we are facing in the world. It is horrifying. It is passing through a vicious stage, terrible moral decline, degradation of human values, no respect or reverence for elders, becoming more and more selfish, self-centered. So that is the situation in which we are all living. So how can we expect peace unless we change our mode of life, unless we take to spirituality in all seriousness? There is a kind of indifference with regards to adherence of dharma. Anyway, it is not with the idea of criticizing the world we are now talking about. The idea is to understand our position, to know where we are, to begin from where we are. So we have to take certain steps. Unless we make effort, it would be impossible to achieve peace in this world. The nature of the world itself is to disturb peace. From the worldly point of view, I am talking. If you look upon the world as the world is, then you are bound to be peaceless. You are bound to be disturbed every moment. Because that is the nature of the world. On the surface, you feel always disturbance. Go deeper. Calm and serene. Ocean, on the surface, lot of turbulence, waves striking the rocks. terrible. But if you go deep into the layers of ocean, you feel how serene and calm. In the same way, the underlying principle in the world is spirituality. If we know it, we become peaceful. How to know it? We have to come and sit at the feet of Sri Ramakrishna with all humbleness. With egoism, you will not be able to understand spirituality. No. Spirituality begins when the ego is completely under control. Ego should not dominate us. That means we must have sufficient qualification to approach the Guru. Studying life and teachings of Sri Ramakrishna means we are approaching the Guru. Sri Ramakrishna is the Parama Guru, the Supreme Teacher, whose heart was given to the whole world. His purity, his spiritual realizations, his resourceful intellect, his love of mankind, and his profound wisdom. The more we look into this, the more we contemplate on these qualities of Sri Ramakrishna, they give us tremendous hope, tremendous inspiration to our baffling problems. The only way to tackle the problems is to take to spiritual path. Not that you should renounce and get rid of everything and go to a forest. That is not the meaning. The meaning is to give importance to spiritual values, to live the life of spirituality wherever we are. Whether we are monks, whether we are householders, anybody for that matter. And Sri Ramakrishna is here to show us the way, both to the all-renouncing monks and householders as well. That is the uniqueness of Sri Ramakrishna's advent. He condemned no religion. He condemned no one. He condemned the condemnation. Nobody should be condemned. So when Sri Ramakrishna pinpointed the divinity of every being, what a tremendous hope for us. What a tremendous hope. Everybody has got that divinity. Only thing is, we must turn inward, live the life accordingly, following the instructions. Then you feel the benefit of it. So, looking from this point of view, Sri Ramakrishna's teachings, they are all recorded in the famous book, Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna Kathamrita, Amrit. Amrit means nectar. Nectar of wisdom. Nectar of wisdom. And his life, Leela Prasang. Leela. How Sri Ramakrishna played his life in this world. He was born in the same world where we are born. He lived the life as most of us live, but with a difference. He lived the life remembering God always. We live the world forgetting God always. So we are always in trouble. And Sri Ramakrishna and holy people are always cheerful because of this. So Sri Ramakrishna's teachings are extremely simple, direct, and most effective. Each one of us can have that experience by reading through Master's life and teachings. Read any page of the Gospel, you will find that. But you must be ready for that. You must be ready. Shraddha must have tremendous shraddha, steadfastness, reverence, devotion, hankering for spiritual knowledge. Then you will get. You won't like to miss anything afterwards. So Sri Ramakrishna says very emphatically, live in the world, at the same time hold on to God with one of your hands. Hold on to God with one of your hands, and with the other hand you hold on to the world. You are not to be afraid of, because you are holding God with one hand. So that is a saving factor. It saves you from disastrous occurrences in the life. It saves you from all dangers, from all troubles. So this is, in a nutshell, a clean and clear solution of the perplexing labyrinth of the tangle of life. Sri Ramakrishna never exhorted anyone to flee from life. That's why he said, everyone's life will be considered as a path to perfection. Everyone's life is a path by itself. So Sri Ramakrishna recognizes all the individual beings. Everyone is important to him. Everyone in this universe is very important to Sri Ramakrishna. So that's a great blessing for all of us. Here is the divine power who is recognizing us. That should make us approach him with all reverence. So he gave easy guidelines to the people living in the world to conduct their life in a proper way. That is, dharma is important. Without dharma, what life it is? Sri Ramakrishna said to one of his disciples, who was confused. He thought to realize God, one has to give up everything and retire to the forest. He thought he might not be strong enough to do that. Then he thought probably he will not have any hope at all. Sri Ramakrishna answers him, why should you give up the world? There is no need of that. You live in the world. Is this world different from God? If you think the world is different from God, then of course you are to worry. If you think the world is not different from God, then you are not to worry at all. Sri Ramakrishna gives the example of a mudfish. Look at the mudfish. It lives in the muddy water, but it is uncontaminated by the mud. We must live in this world like that. Don't get tainted by worldliness. If you have to open the jackfruit, smear the hand with oil, and then open the jackfruit, the milk of the jackfruit doesn't stick to your hands. If you don't smear the hands with the greasy thing, then you will not be able to open the jackfruit at all. Your hands get stuck up there. In the same way, holding on to God, remembering the Divine, instilling faith in the all-loving person who guides the whole universe, that makes us easy to swim in this world. Remembering God will enable us to swim in the world. Without remembering God, there is every chance we may be drowned in the world, in the waters of the world. Sri Ramakrishna pointed out to the noble example of Sri Ramachandra. In the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, we find in many places Sri Ramakrishna referring to some incidents in Sri Ramachandra's life taken from Adhyatma Ramayana. At one time, in his boyhood days, Sri Ramachandra wanted to become an ascetic. The idea came to him, what is this world? Let me go to the forest. So, because his mind was set in that direction, he became disinterested in worldly pursuits. Then everybody became very serious. Why Sri Rama is thinking this way? Then the guru of the king, his name was Vasishtha Maharshi. Vasishtha was the guru of the king. Whenever there would be any crisis, the tradition was to consult the guru. And whatever the guru says, it would be followed. That great reverence to the guru was a remarkable feature we find in olden days. When Vasishtha came to know it, he said, Rama, why should you give up the world? Think deeply. Is God outside this world? The whole universe itself is a manifestation of His glory. The universe is here. The whole creation is playing on account of the presence of God. Therefore, you live in this world. Then he said further, how to live in the world? To live in the world like animals? No, no. He says, live in this world, but be conscious of doing the duties. Do your duty, following dharma. Be a good and noble example to the rest of the mankind. This remarkable advice of Vasishtha was in reality a panacea for all evils that existed and exist in the world for generations. So, what we should forsake is not the world, but the evils that are in us. What are those evils? Lust, anger, big list. I did not have to give the list of those evils. You know everything very well. So, doing thy duty is a very important aspect for the people living in the world, engaging themselves in worldly activities day in and day out. They have to be very careful in their life. If they perform their duties properly, then even though they are in this world, they are safe in the spiritual path. God's help will be always there. They will be able to overcome all crises in their life. Doing the duty is a very important aspect. That Sri Ramakrishna emphasizes very much. Remember God and do whatever you want. Negligence or avoidance of one's duty is surely not dharma. So, our duty is to see that our karma is performed for the sake of upholding dharma. It is this fundamental principle that Sri Ramakrishna reiterated
in all his sayings.
Perform all your duties in the world at the same time. Keep remembrance of God firmly planted in your mind. Let all your karma be an offering to God. When you consider, when you think that all your doings would be offered to God, that very idea should make you to understand that you have to conduct yourself properly, without indifference, with great Shraddha and devotion. So, we find Sri Ramakrishna's advent just at the crucial time to stem the tide of religious anarchy. But the ideas of Sri Ramakrishna must be made known to the people more and more. It's not enough what we are doing, spreading the message of Sri Ramakrishna. Everybody, the member of this ashram, should himself become a representative of Sri Ramakrishna and try to spread the message of peace and harmony. Whoever comes around you, whoever comes in association, in your association, you must be able to exhibit this fine spiritual quality. So Sri Ramakrishna's whole life is religion in practice. He defined the purest form of religion through his own practical experience. So he proved that religion is the manifestation of divinity already in us. Religion is being and becoming. Religion is realization. All these facts Sri Ramakrishna experienced in the present life. So here is an assurance for us that we can reach that supreme height of blessedness if we follow spiritual instructions. Sri Ramakrishna, by emphasizing the practice of religion, he was not opposed to science. He was not opposed to material prosperity. In fact, material prosperity and progress are quite necessary for human welfare. Nobody denies that. But one thing Sri Ramakrishna points out here, it is that all this prosperity and progress and all these things, they have their use and meaning only when the virtues like sympathy and forbearance, love and peace reign supreme in the hearts of people. If you cherish values in life and then aspire for material prosperity, wonderful, most welcome. So, how to practice these values in our life? That means spiritual culture is necessary. Spiritual culture. Physical culture for developing physical body, mental culture for developing mind, and spiritual culture for developing spirituality. You have to go in a definite way. And Sri Ramakrishna shows the ways of developing, nurturing spiritual culture. So Sri Ramakrishna took religion very seriously. It was not simply a theory or a dogma. So he began to practice religion in all earnestness, because his whole body and mind were pure, he could experience it immediately. Then he wanted to find out the truth in other religions. Why people fight in the name of religions? Is there any truth in the other religion? He wanted to find out. So apart practicing from Hinduism, he practiced Christianity, he practiced Islam. Everywhere he arrived at the same truth. So then only he gave that famous message, Jatamat Tatapat. As many faiths, so many paths. What a wonderful statement. If we believe in this message, then there should be harmony amongst ourselves. There should not be any more fight at all. Why should there be any fight? You practice in your own way, I practice in my own way. One need not convert the other. This conversion is, it's a cheap way of understanding religion. In fact, conversion is not religion at all. It will have negative effect. So, looking from this point of view, because Sri Ramakrishna practiced all these religions, major religions of the world, and then he gave out that message, And he sent Swami Vivekananda to broadcast this wonderful message of Vedanta, this spiritual culture, to the whole world. Swami Vivekananda was prepared by Sri Ramakrishna. So Sri Ramakrishna is the messiah of spiritual democracy. Spiritual democracy. We are all very fond of the word democracy, you know. Sri Ramakrishna also is an example in that respect. A genuine Catholicity pervaded Sri Ramakrishna's spiritual consciousness. His spiritual realization included the wholeness of divinity and the allness of humanity. His mysticism proves that not only super persons may attain the highest, but even most ordinary common man may unfold his divinity. That's remarkable. His methods are unique. He does not strike. He does not denounce. By gentle, unaggressive, and unpretentious means, he clarifies the whole atmosphere of doubt and fear and fills the mind with positive thoughts. Once they come and talk with Sri Ramakrishna, they go back highly refreshed, as if they were transformed. Sri Ramakrishna has given the gospel of spirit more than any theological creed or any philosophical theory. He stressed the movement of spirit and its expression through the finer rhythm of the heart, the diviner movement of the will, and the luminous intuition of intellect. Sri Ramakrishna was the herald of the unity of spirit and matter. He realized that spirit and matter are one. It is even wrong to mention two names, two words. Matter is the expression of spirit. It is a symbol of spirit. Nay, more, it is spirit itself. Sri Ramakrishna discovers the natural gravitation of life to spirit. It is this fine spiritual appeal that makes Sri Ramakrishna's life at once an attraction and a wonder. Sri Ramakrishna is a great apostle of spiritual struggle for human liberty. Of Sri Ramakrishna's teachings, it may justly be said that from his lips came the religion that spiritualizes philosophy. Sri Ramakrishna's life inspires us to hush all notes of discord by emphasizing the central unity and making room for all the varieties of creeds that add to the beauty, richness, strength and grandeur of the house of religion. Suppose we make a garland of flowers, all varieties of flowers. How beautiful it looks. Unity in diversity. That principle Sri Ramakrishna gives to the world. His life inspires us to remain strictly loyal to our individual churches and yet embrace the followers of all other creeds as fellow pilgrims on the path of blessedness. We must cherish the idea of friendliness. Friendliness is a very good idea. His life appears to be a symbolic suggestion of a new era when all sect-bound thoughts will be released, all narrowness and bigotry will disappear, when religion will be comprehended in terms of universal humanity, and all the varying notes issuing out of the different creeds of the world will combine to form a magnificent and undreamt of harmony of religions. So we find in Sri Ramakrishna's life people belonging to different religion coming to Sri Ramakrishna, and each person feels that Sri Ramakrishna belongs to him. The followers of Lord Christ would feel Sri Ramakrishna as Lord Christ himself. The followers of Sri Ramachandra would find Sri Rama himself in Sri Ramakrishna. Same way, the devotees of Krishna would see Krishna in him. So in whatever form they want to adore the divine, they are welcome. Sri Ramakrishna says, everyone is true. God is the center. All different religions are radii. They all lead to the center, God only. Ekam sad vipra bahuda vadanti. God is one, called by different names, by different people. That's all. Same God is referred to. Once Sri Ramakrishna visited Brahma Samaj in Calcutta, there is a signboard at the entrance. It read, people belonging to other faiths are not allowed to come into the meeting place. Narendranath, later who became Vivekananda, had warned Sri Ramakrishna not to go to Brahma Samaj because of that signboard. But Sri Ramakrishna did go there in order to correct them. Sri Ramakrishna said that attitude is not correct. We are all calling on the same God. Why should there be any jealousy or malice? Some say God is formless, some say God has form. Whoever believes God has got form, let him worship God with that form. Whoever believes God has no form, let him worship God in the formless aspect. What is needed is practice. What is needed is discipline. What is needed is character, purity, humbleness, straightforwardness, simplicity. If these things are there, you approach God in any manner you want. Any manner. Your life becomes blessed. Sri Ramakrishna gives the example. A mother has got 5 children. She prepares dishes. She knows a particular child has weak stomach. So accordingly she prepares a soup that is suitable to that particular child. So she does not prepare the same dish for all the people. She loves all her children equally. That's the way we should have with respect to religions also. Another important aspect which Sri Ramakrishna emphasized was that God himself will correct those errors. God, to whom the whole universe belongs, takes care of that. But dogmatism is not good. Dogmatism. What I say alone is true. All others are foolish. That attitude is terribly bad. So Sri Ramakrishna gives an example. Once a man was walking in the woods. He saw a particular lizard on a tree. It was bright red in color. It was so fascinating. So, while coming back, he met one of his friends and while talking, he said, "Look, today I saw a wonderful lizard on a tree. It was so bright red. So fascinating color." When he said this, the other friend said, what are you talking? You are talking nonsense. It is not red. Probably your eyes are colored. It is green. What? I have seen with my own eyes, with open eyes I have seen that bird, the lizard as red, and you are telling it is green. You are condemning me. So they were quarreling like this about the color of the lizard. It so happened third man came there. "What are you talking about?" This fellow was telling that lizard was red. The other one was telling it was green. Then third man came. "Both of you are wrong. Both of you are not correct. It is yellow." He's telling. He is giving another color. So, the fighting developed. Fighting was between two people. Now it began to three. So, all people began to gather. Then finally, let us all go there and see the bird, see the lizard ourselves and then judge the thing. Then they all went there. Under the tree, there was one old man. He was always lying there. He saw the crowd coming towards the tree. What has happened to these people? He questioned them. What is the matter? Why are you quarreling? What for you are quarreling? And everyone began to tell. No, he is telling the lizard is red color. It is wrong. It is yellow. The other one is telling, no, it is wrong. It is green. So each fellow is giving in his own way the description of the lizard. What is the correct way? We want to know the correct thing. And this man said, "Why are you quarreling for nothing? What all of you have said is true. The bird, the lizard is sometimes red, sometimes yellow, sometimes green, sometimes it is colorless. So all of you are true. But the truth is this, it changes its color now and then." When they heard this, all their dogmatism vanished. Then they all became friends once again, when the truth was realized. Same way, we are all fighting in the name of God. It's all nonsense, stupidity. A person who practices religion properly will never condemn anybody. On the other hand, he will put all his attention towards realizing the truth. Then, if time permits, let him go and give lectures to all the people about the experience he had. So Sri Ramakrishna has a wonderful way of explaining the things through beautiful analogies. He gave the example of water. Some people call it water, some people call it vari, some as aqua, some as jal, some as pani. Same water has got different names. Different people, different communities calling the water by different names. But all are referring to water only. That's the point. In the same way, each community is calling on God in his own way, but everybody is calling the same God. Sri Ramakrishna gives another example. Suppose we go to a potter's store, person who makes pots. Different shapes and different forms of pots are there. Jars, dishes, plates, etc. Varieties. But all these different varieties, shapes, forms, they are all made of the same clay. Clay is the substance. Whatever form, whatever shape it has got. Even so, God is one, but he is worshipped in different ages and climes under different names and aspects. He gives the example of gold. Various ornaments are made of gold, different shape, different forms, different names, different attraction. But their substance is the same gold.
Gold is the same substance.
Even so, different countries worship different forms with different names according to different conceptions. Some may like to regard God as father, some as mother, some people regard him as friend, and so on and so forth. But it's always one and the same God that is worshipped in all these diverse relations. One can ascend to the top of a house by means of a ladder, or a bamboo, or a staircase, or a rope. By any means you can go to the rooftop. Even so, there are many ways to approach God, and each religion in the world shows one of the ways. He gives another very wonderful parable. See, if you go through these stories, how nicely Sri Ramakrishna pinpoints the thing what he wants to tell us, the instructions, the spiritual idea. Once some blind people came near an animal, somebody asked them, how do you feel that animal? They call it as an elephant. So how do you feel? You please explain. Describe how you feel about it. So there are about three or four people, blind people. One of them went near the animal and touching a part of the body, he said, oh, elephant is like a pillar. It is like a pillar. Why he came to that conclusion? Because he has touched the leg of the elephant. The leg, you know, it is of the size of the pillar. So he said, elephant is like a pillar. Another fellow came there. He was also blind. He said, elephant is like a winnowing fan because he touched the elephant's ear. So like that, each person giving his own description about the elephant. Some people, having touched its tail or belly, gave their different versions of the elephant. So, in the same manner, a person who has seen only one aspect of God limits God to that alone. It is his conviction that God cannot be anything else. But the truth is, a person who realizes the God will know the exact truth of how God would be. So God can take forms and he can be formless as well. Thus we find Sri Ramakrishna giving practical instructions to various types of devotees coming to him, and he led people to spiritual path in so many ways. Some of the teachings of Sri Ramakrishna are worth mentioning. Useless is the study of the scriptures if one has no discrimination and dispassion. One cannot find God unless one is endowed with this. Discrimination or viveka is knowledge of what is eternal and what is non-eternal, and devotion to the eternal, which is God. It is knowledge that the Atman is separate from the body. Dispassion is non-attachment to the objects of the sense. The true hero is he who can discipline his mind by devotional exercises while living in the world. A strong man can look in any direction while carrying a heavy burden on his head. Similarly, the perfect man can keep his gaze constantly fixed on God while carrying the burden of worldly duties. A boy holds on to a pillar and circles around it with headlong speed. While he is spinning, his attention is constantly fixed on the pillar. He knows that if he lets go his hold upon it, he will fall and hurt himself. Similarly, the wise householder holds on to the pillar of God, keeps his mind fixed on him, and performs his worldly duties. Thus, he is free from all dangers. Let the boat stay on the water, there is no harm, but let not water get into the boat, lest the boat sink. Similarly, there is no harm if the devotee lives in the world, provided he lets not worldliness enter into his mind. Clay in its natural state can be molded into any form, but burnt clay cannot. Similarly, spiritual truths cannot be impressed upon hearts that have been burnt by the fire of lust. The magnetic needle always points towards the north, whatever the direction in which the ship is sailing. That's why the ship doesn't lose her course. Similarly, if the mind of a person is always turned towards God, he will steer clear of every danger. Earnestness is the only thing necessary. Long must you struggle in the water before you learn to swim. The goal of human life is to realize God. In the pure is reflected the Lord as the sun in the clear mirror. God shines when ego dies. Like unto a miser that longeth for gold, Let thy heart long for the Lord. Call on the Divine Mother. She will come to you and take you up in her arms. Mahatma Gandhi, in his foreword to Sri Ramakrishna's biography, referred to Sri Ramakrishna as a living embodiment of godliness. He said, "The story of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa's life is a story of religion in practice. His life enables us to see God face to face. No one can read the story of his life without being convinced that God alone is real and all else is an illusion." Ramakrishna was a living embodiment of godliness. His sayings are not those of a mere learned man, but they are pages from the book of life. They are revelations of his own experiences. They therefore leave on the reader an impression which he cannot resist. In this age of skepticism, Sri Ramakrishna presents an example of bright and living faith which gives solace to thousands of people who would otherwise have remained without spiritual light. Ramakrishna's life was an object lesson in ahimsa, non-injury. His love knew no limits, geographical or otherwise. So Sri Ramakrishna belongs to the whole world. The whole world belongs to Sri Ramakrishna. That is how we should look into the great personality, Sri Ramakrishna. Let us try to practice the spiritual instructions given by Sri Ramakrishna to the best of our capacity and make our life blessed. Thank you all.
Om. Sahanavavato sahanau bhunakto sahaviryam karavavahai tejasvinavadhitamastu ma vidvishavahai. Om shanti shanti shanti. Hari Om Tat Sat.
Peace, peace, peace be unto all.